Welcome to the show. I'm your host, Kyle Duffy, and you're listening to Is a Recording, a podcast for passions. Episodes are available on Spotify, Anchor FM, Google Podcasts, and many more platforms like this. New to Is a Recording? Follow the podcast on Spotify so you never miss an episode. New uploads every Friday. I'm very excited about what I have in store for you today. I hope you all enjoy it. Let's get things started. Hello people and welcome to the podcast you are listening to Is a Recording, available on Spotify, Anchor FM, Google Podcasts and many more platforms like this. If you're new to the podcast, welcome, hope you enjoy it, and if you do, make sure to check out the rest of my catalogue available up on these platforms. No matter what podcast platform you listen to, make sure to give Is a Recording some love, share the episode with your friends and follow along for new content. In today's episode, I'll be giving you a few updates around my Midwest radio placement, which I started this week. I specified in last week's episode that the podcast might take a hit on the scheduling uploads because of my new schedule with Midwest Radio. I usually upload a podcast episode every Friday, and because of my new schedule, I might only get time to upload every 2 weeks from now on. So if you do see a fluctuation and a change in the schedule of uploading, that's why. But I'll be diving into what I've learned so far on the placement. It's only been a couple of days, but I was thrown in the deep end. I'm learning a lot, so I'll be diving into that. I'll also be talking Emmy results and Emmy history, which was made this past week when the 74th annual Emmys took place. A lot of big winners. We'll be talking on that. As always, in today's episode, I'll be giving my movie review of the week and my movie recommendation of the week. Along with this, I'll be giving an updated review around She-Hulk, which I reviewed last week. I'd only seen one episode since then. I've kind of dived into it a bit. I think I've watched three or four in total now, and I want to give you a run-by-run play of what I'm thinking of this TV show, because there is a lot of buzz around it, bad buzz at this stage now. But I wanted to give an updated review around it. Today's episode might be a bit shorter than usual, and please forgive me if I sound a bit worn out and tired. I am still getting used to the schedule of the internship I'm on at the moment and getting used to traveling every day. So if I do sound a bit tired and lethargic, that's why. Overall, guys, Midwest is just such a dream start. To be honest, I thought I would be thrown in the deep end and really have to struggle to keep up with things, and I thought I'd be in my own head about getting things right and be really nervous and be a nervous wreck all around. But I have to say, I'm taken to Midwest like a fish to water, and I'm so happy that I am. I didn't think I would, to be honest. I thought I'd be really in my own head around what I was doing and be second guessing myself. This week, obviously, it's much of my duties I'm just overlooking and shadowing people and observing the ins and outs and the day-to-day runnings of the radio station. I'm starting off in the news sector and the sports sector to see how that is run and what goes into producing a news segment and the day-to-day runnings and schedule of someone working in the news sector. There's a lot more than I thought that goes into it. And anyone who thinks radio is easy and they can just show up and read their bit of news and then go home, I think it's totally overestimated or underestimated how much work that goes into producing news. Maybe I'm wrong on that. Maybe most people have a good perception of how much work goes into it. But I feel overall, I think people underestimate how much work goes into radio and production of those kind of segments. I'm learning now that there's a lot that goes into it. I already kind of knew that there was a good bit that went into it, but not as much as I thought. The people I'm working with so far, I'm really learning a lot from, and really nice people. Again, like I said, I haven't come across a bad person in radio yet. Obviously, there'll always be someone you'll disagree with and that you'll have to get used to working with, but from my experience so far, everyone has given me the time of day, has been really kind and encouraging. And it's great to be in an environment, especially a new environment and a fast-paced work environment, where people give you the time to learn things right and encourage you that it's not a big deal if you get things wrong as well. I think a lot of people going into new jobs, especially younger people, they feel like they can't ask questions or they can't do things wrong or get things wrong to start off with, and they feel like they have to be a perfectionist most of the time. Maybe not, that's how I feel or how I felt most times going into new jobs. I felt like I couldn't put a foot wrong to begin with because I had to make sure I started off on the right foot. But a good work environment will allow you to make mistakes, will allow you to ask questions and not make you feel stupid for doing so. Some places do, some places don't. Midwest Radio has welcomed me with open arms and really made me feel like a part of the team already, which is a great environment to be in and a great feeling to get going into somewhere new, especially somewhere like Midwest Radio with the reputation they have in the broadcasting community. Again, like I mentioned, I'll make sure to keep you updated around my internship in Midwest Radio. If this is something you like hearing and you're interested in getting into broadcasting and radio journalism as well, and you want to know what is waiting for you in a job like this, let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify and Twitter, and I can talk more about it on the podcast. So really looking forward to making the most of the rest of my 5 months with Midwest Radio and learning more about what goes into making a great radio show. Before I discuss this year's Emmy nominees and winners, it's time for my movie review of the week, along with my movie/TV recommendation of the week. For this week's movie review, I'll be discussing Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
I'm Rick Dalton. It's my pleasure, Mr. Schwartz.
Call me Marvin. Put it down. That your son?
No, it's my stunt double, Cliff Booth.
Last night, we watched a Rick Dalton double feature. All the shooting. I love that stuff, you know, with the killing.
A lot of killing.
Anybody order fried sauerkraut? Can you not see bastards?
No, I'm a stuntman.
Look at me.
So you still with Rick, huh?
Still here.
You can do anything you want to him.
I hired you to be an actor, Rick. Not a TV cowboy. You're better than that.
Line. Cut! Embarrass yourself like that in front of all those goddamn people.
All right, what's the matter, partner?
It's official, old buddy. Well, it has been.
An August night and the leaves hanging down and the grass on the ground.
Here I am, flat on my ass. And who I got living next door to me?
I'm Sharon Tate. I'm in the movie.
You're in this?
That's me. I play Miss Carlson, the Klutz.
It's a ragged tent.
Charlie's gonna dig you.
And that gospel group telling you
in this town,
I can all change like that.
You're Rick fucking Dalton. Don't you forget it.
I absolutely love this movie. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood was released in 2019. It's obviously directed by Quentin Tarantino. It stars Leonardo DiCaprio, Brad Pitt, Margot Robbie, Austin Butler from the recent Elvis movie, Kurt Russell, Al Pacino, and recent Emmy nominee Margaret Qualley. The movie focuses around a struggling, aging actor who is trying to transition from TV star to movie star, played by Leonardo DiCaprio, and Brad Pitt, along with him as his stunt double, is trying to ride his coattails to fame. Overall, this movie offers us something different. The cinematography alone is a reason to go and watch this movie. Tarantino does one thing very well, and it's making mundane situations feel like events, feel like something important. And he does this throughout his career. There's one movie in particular, Reservoir Dogs, where all the men involved in the heist are talking about the concept of tipping waitresses in a restaurant. and they have a deep intellectual conversation around it. I think Steve Buscemi leads that conversation and that monologue in that scene. Overall, Tarantino does conversation, mundane conversation, very well. When you're watching a Tarantino movie, I think every sentence, every conversation matters. It has depth to it. Even if it's about mundane things, like I mentioned, you're hooked from the moment the dialogue starts. And that's what Tarantino does very well. He hooks us in and then just explores conversations, gives us great cinematography, and gives us something different and unique in a familiar way. And he did this again with Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Over to the performances now, because a movie is nothing without great performances. You can't look past Leonardo DiCaprio in his role as Rick Dalton. He is charismatic, he is likable, he is relatable in a lot of the scenes. One scene in particular that had me and Leanne in stitches is when he gets back to his trailer after messing up a scene and a reading in his new TV show, and he's just beating himself up and telling himself, listen, you need to get your shit together, you're an alcoholic, you need to stop drinking while you're reading your lines because you're fucking everything up. And it is such a relatable scene, because I think everyone has that moment where they're so hard on themselves and beating themselves up. But Leonardo DiCaprio does it in such a funny way. And overall, DiCaprio's character, Rick Dalton, is so funny and relatable in that way, because he holds in all this insecurity and then just offloads it in this moment of self-hatred. And I think we've all had that moment where we've been really hard on ourselves and we've given ourselves grief for something we've messed up in the past, whether that's something at work or something in a relationship, and we've got that guilt trip going through our system. We never see that in other movies that focus around actors and Hollywood. And in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, we see the fact that an actor as big as Rick Dalton is in this universe is still insecure about his own achievements, about his own ability as an actor to sell a movie, to make money, to be that main guy in Hollywood. And that's something his character struggles with throughout the movie. He's worried that going from movie to TV is a jump down and something that should be looked down upon. And because he's going from movie, cowboy movies, to cowboy TV shows, that his career is now washing up and he's trying to make sure that he's still relevant in Hollywood. And to add insult to injury, he's living next to Roman Polanski and Sharon Tate, who was one of the biggest actresses in the world at that time, based around the 80s. And he sees how they're living and is comparing his own life to theirs and trying to make sure that he becomes friends with them so he can stay relevant. At times, most times in this movie, Rick Dalton on screen as a character is probably one of the best in the movie. We also have Brad Pitt, who is, in a sense, a blacklisted stunt double who only works for Rick Dalton because of personal reasons. He's not easy to work with. He's kind of blackballed from Hollywood sets because of his bad behavior and some dark rumors that he murdered his ex-wife. Brad Pitt's character of Cliff is a polar opposite to Rick's character. Rick is a optimist. He is very vulnerable. He says how he feels a lot of the time. He wears his emotions on his sleeve, whereas Cliff is a realist. He knows his days in Hollywood are numbered. He knows he's basically blacklisted from any set without Rick Dalton there because of the rumors surrounding his ex-wife's death and his involvement in it. Overall, I loved his relationship on screen with Rick Dalton, and the chemistry between Leonardo DiCaprio and Brad Pitt in this movie was one of the best reasons to go and watch it. Great to see them on screen together, and the dynamic they had was excellent. You could really see the friendship there, and it worked on screen. As I mentioned in the synopsis of the movie, Sharon Tate is displayed on screen by Margot Robbie in this movie, and they don't really focus around the marriage with Roman Polanski. She is maybe a side character, if anything, in this movie. That's not to say she doesn't have much to do. There is a great subplot written into the end and the finale of this movie that is really entertaining and really unique. The final few scenes of this movie acts as an alternate universe and an alternate reality to what happened to Sharon Tate. Obviously, in real life, Sharon Tate was a victim and murdered by the Manson family in the 80s. But this movie rewrites history. I really loved the finale of this movie. I wasn't expecting it. And the ultra violence near the end of the movie kind of hits you over the head. And Tarantino is very good at going from 0 to 100 with the violence in his movies. I wasn't expecting that much violence packed into one or two scenes. But because it went from 0 to 100, it kind of got your heart rate going at the end and gave you an extra layer to the movie when you were watching it. I know personally, I wasn't expecting this ending. I wasn't expecting the violence. And I was enjoying the movie overall. I was just trying to figure out, how is this movie going to end? And overall, I thought it was a great ending. It gave me that extra bit that I thought was missing from the movie. As an ending, I thought it was very satisfying. It had a sense of justice with it. And obviously the action on top of that was great. You know, Rick Dalton, Leonardo DiCaprio with a flamethrower. Who's not going to love that? And the scene with Brad Pitt killing the hippies. That's where the satisfaction comes in. Because knowing what the Manson family did in real life makes you cheer for the actions of Cliff Booth in that final scene. And Rick Dalton, they're kind of heroes at the end of the movie. And because of their heroics, this finally gives Rick Dalton a chance to get in good with his neighbors, Roman Polanski and Sharon Tate, and make sure that he can cement his relevance in Hollywood history. Overall, guys, if you haven't seen Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, I would highly recommend it. It gets a 5 out of 5 from me. Great cinematography, great acting, great concept for a movie. And a beautiful movie to watch at times. If you've seen this movie, let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify and Twitter. What did you think of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood? Are you a fan of Quentin Tarantino's work? Do you hope he makes an 11th movie? Or have you had your fill? Let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify and Twitter. My recommendation this week is the thriller series and Emmy-nominated Severance, released in 2022, starring Adam Scott, Patricia Arquette, Britt Lower, John Turturro and Zach Cherry. The series is beautifully directed by Ben Stiller and Aoife McArdle, who do a great job in each episode. The series gives us a dystopian look at what the workplace could look like 10, 20 years from now, who knows. Great acting in this series from Adam Scott. He got a nod as a nominee for Best Actor in a Drama Series. I don't think he won the nomination in the end. We'll be talking about the Emmys in a few minutes. But overall, a great performance in this series from him. I also really liked Britt Lower's performance in this series, as well as that Patricia Arquette is a character that you love to hate in this series. Overall, Severance is a show that I would recommend to anyone. I plan on reviewing it in more detail on the podcast down the line, but it's definitely one you should have in your watch list. I did, and I checked it off, and I'm so glad I did. It should be available to watch up on Apple TV. If you have seen the show, let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify and Twitter what your thoughts are. And if you haven't seen Severance, take this episode as your sign to go and watch it. Before I get into the Emmys and discussions around this year's nominees, I just wanted to reflect on last week's episode. I was discussing Don't Worry Darling and all the drama around that. I actually went back and looked at the video, the so-called spitting video with Harry Styles and Chris Pine. And to be honest, with further reflection and watching the video a couple of times, it's quite obvious that no spit leaves his mouth and that it's just a badly timed video. I am glad that he didn't do that because I do like Harry Styles. I do like his music. I do like what he's molding out in terms of his career path and the choices he's making as an actor. He seems to really be progressing and he seems to be setting himself up as a David Bowie type figure, very androgynous, very willing to walk that line in terms of fashion, in terms of statements and stuff like that, and just being comfortable in his own skin. So I am glad that the whole spitting incident doesn't seem to be true. Again, looking back on the video, the body language of Chris Pine, the body language of Harry Styles, the two men sit beside each other. They don't argue. There's no aggression on Chris Pine's face. He doesn't have an overt reaction to Harry Styles sitting down and the so-called incident. So really, that's what you go off. You go off the body language. And I think I got swept away with all the drama hitting that set and everything that was going on the set of Don't Worry Darling, that I kind of attached it to that clip. And obviously when a bunch of people are putting stuff up online and you just see a microcosm or a microsecond of a clip, you kind of put two and two together and you think, okay, this is more drama added to the scene and added to the movie overall. But from looking at the video in full and the body language of Chris Pine and Harry Styles, and the fact that Chris Pine didn't really react in a manner that is fitting to being spit on, that it's obvious that that wasn't the case. And Chris Pine seems like a person who isn't going to stand for being spat on. Who would stand for that kind of behavior? You're obviously going to have a really aggressive and confrontational reaction to that. But the fact that both men sat down beside each other, there was no argument, there was all smiles and laughs. So again, looking at the full scope of the video, it's obvious that no spitting took place. It was just a badly timed video. And as I said, I'm glad that the spitting incident wasn't true and isn't true, because I like Harry Styles. Obviously, there is some drama, like I mentioned, on the set, but it doesn't seem to extend past Olivia Wilde and Florence Pugh. Okay, with all that said, let's discuss this year's Emmys, because some history was made.
And now, the Emmy for Lead Actress in a Drama Series. Hold on. Zendaya!
We got not one, but two milestones in this year's Emmys, with both Lee Jung-jae of Squid Game and Zendaya of Euphoria making Emmys history and an Emmys first for the award ceremony. Lee Jung-jae being the first actor of Asian descent to win Best Lead Actor in a Drama Series at the Emmys, and Zendaya making history again as the first Black actress to win Best Lead Actress in a Drama Series. I haven't seen all of Euphoria. I've seen bits and pieces. Her portrayal as Rue is primarily the biggest reason people watch that show, in my opinion, because her acting is excellent. It's off the charts, really. And going back to last week's episode, when I discussed the Emmy nominations and giving my predictions with Jack McDonald in last week's show, I think we both touted Zendaya to win that category. How could you not bet on Zendaya to win that? She has had a stellar year of acting. In fact, the last few years, Zendaya has given us some great performances across movie and TV. Obviously, her portrayal in the Spider-Man series alongside Tom Holland, her movie Malcolm and Marie, as well as Dune, which did very well at the Oscars, and of course, Euphoria, which she was recognized for in the Emmys. Really big night for both Euphoria and Squid Game. And I think overall, great TV was recognized in this ceremony. Over to a few more of the winners for Outstanding Drama Series. We had Succession winning that category. I think, you know, someone who hasn't seen Succession but has heard a lot about it, you know, it's one of those movies, or sorry, one of those TV shows where you knew it was going to be recognized in some category. Outstanding Comedy Series, Ted Lasso. I really love that series. I think I'm on season 2 at the moment, as far as I know, or in the latter half of season 1. And I spoke about this show in last week's episode as well with Jack McDonald, who really has what I would see as a disdain for the show. Only seen 15 minutes of it. But again, he has a very convicted mindset when it comes to movies and TV shows, I found out. But overall, I really like the show. Again, it's not giving you too much melodrama and too much reality with the football side of things. It's focused on the heart of the football team, around the emotional connections in the show and the relationships that goes into football as well. And for that reason, I do really like it. Again, if I want realism in football, I'll watch a football documentary. And obviously, Ted Lasso being a comedy, you're going to expect certain situations to be taken out of context, amplified for comedy's sake. And in those kind of TV shows, you can't take anything too seriously, because at the end of the day, it's not a documentary. It's not being over analytic of football. And when you get down to it, it is a workplace comedy like Parks and Rec, like The Office, and that's what you need to treat it as. When you look at it through the scope of football, obviously certain realities aren't there. It's not going to match up to real life, but no comedy really matches up to real life. Overall, I really love Ted Lasso as a show. I can't wait to watch more of it. Let me know what you think of the show up on Anchor FM, Spotify, and Twitter. On to the next category, which is Outstanding Limited Series, won by The White Lotus. I really have to go and watch this series now because I think Jack had mentioned a few things in last week's episode about it, and I had seen that Jennifer Coolidge actually won Best Supporting Actress in a miniseries or in a limited series for her role in The White Lotus as well. So it did get some recognition at this year's Emmys. And really, there's so much TV out there. And especially in the last year or so, we've got so many TV shows hitting us on different streaming platforms. It's hard to get to see them all. But I think the Emmys and the spotlight of the Emmys for these TV shows will reignite the flame for viewers and remind us of all the TV shows we have left to watch. So The White Lotus winning there in Outstanding Limited Series. Lead actor in a drama, obviously, like I mentioned, Lee Jun-jae. I thought his performance throughout Squid Game was immense. Such a stellar performance. And looking back at how much I enjoyed watching Squid Game, how much of an impact it made across the world, the records it broke as probably Netflix's best series to date, you couldn't really overlook Squid Game as a series coming into this year's Emmys. I think it was bound to win in some category, and no better category than Best Leading Actor in a Drama Series, because Lee Jun-jae did such a good job in that series throughout the show. Lead Actor in a Comedy, I kind of touted one of the Only Murders in the Building cast. I think I went for Martin Short in last week's episode. When I was talking to Jack around this category, we did have a discussion around the fact that maybe the Emmys would honour Martin Short and Steve Martin and give them one last hurrah, because it does look like the duo are ending their career in acting and in Hollywood. Especially Steve Martin, I think this will be his last project to date, and I would have thought that the Emmys would have used this platform to send them off right. But again, Ted Lasso stealing the show, as this series has done in the past since its release. Jason Sudeikis winning Lead Actor in a Comedy Series. I kind of can't disagree with this, because as someone who's watched Ted Lasso and Only Murders in the Building, I did enjoy Ted Lasso as a character a bit more than Charles and Oliver as characters. I just wanted a bit more from Steve Martin and Martin Short in this. It felt like they were holding back in scenes, and I wanted a bit more of their dynamic on screen. Don't get me wrong, I really enjoy them. They're the best part of Only Murders in the Building for me. Like I mentioned in my detailed review of season 2 of Only Murders, I was disappointed with season 2. It still has a 99% up on Rotten Tomatoes. And season 1 fully deserves a 99%. I loved season 1. Season 2 slowly got worse for me. I am hopeful that a season 3 will come out and that it will redeem season 2. But overall, disappointed with season 2. Let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify, and Twitter. Do you agree with Jason Sudeikis getting Best Lead Actor in a Comedy? Do you think someone is overlooked in this category? Let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify, and Twitter. Next category, we have Lead Actor in a Limited Series. I don't remember what prediction I gave last week around this category, but I definitely touted Michael Keaton as one to watch for this category. Absolutely love him in Dopesick. Such a great series. Go and watch it up on Disney Plus if you haven't already. Really worth your time. Michael Keaton getting recognized and duly deserved in that category. Next up, we have Best Lead Actress in a Drama. Obviously, Zendaya winning that for her stellar performance in the show Euphoria. Best part about the show for me, along with Sydney Sweeney, who also got a nomination for Best Supporting Actress in a Drama Series. On to Lead Actress in Comedy, we had Jean Smart from Hacks. Jack McDonald will be very happy with that. He spoke very highly of the series Hacks. I'll have to give it a watch now, just to maybe shut him up. If I talk to him next, he'll be talking about how good Hacks is. Lead Actress in a Limited Series, we have Amanda Seyfried for The Dropout. Again, the Emmys is just reminding us of how many great shows there are out there and how many great shows we have left to watch. I think a lot of people are saying great things about Amanda Siegfried's performance in The Dropout. I always say Siegfried, but it's Siegfried. And trying to pronounce her name sometimes, it really confuses me. But one thing I have heard about her performance in The Dropout is it's very real to life. She plays Elizabeth Holmes, obviously the real person who the whole series is centered around. I'll have to give it a watch. Let me know if you've seen The Dropout up on Anchor FM, Spotify, and Twitter. What are your thoughts? Just one or two more nominations to get through here. Best Supporting Actress in a Comedy, Cheryl Lee Ralph in Abbott Elementary. Again, another show that I need to get on top of. I have seen a couple episodes, but again, with so many different TV shows to choose from, it's hard to stay focused on just one for too long. Abbott Elementary is a show that I've heard a lot about. Seen a couple episodes, like I mentioned, and definitely seen the potential there as well. And Cheryl Lee Ralph is a great character actress that I really love in a lot of different other movies. And she does a great job in Abbott Elementary as well. So great to see that she was recognized for her work. Best Supporting Actress in a Drama, Julia Garner. Really great performance in Ozark. I found her a bit annoying to start off and I was like, why are we focusing on her? But her character development in the show is immense. And she's not just another character that is taken advantage of or played out by Jason Bateman's character. She does have a lot of character development and definition in this show. Ozark was a show that I got to season 2. I think I got to season 2 and then I fell off for a bit. That tends to happen with me. Like, let me know if this happens with you too. You're fully into a show and then you just drop out of nowhere. And it takes you ages to get up the motivation to start watching it again. I need to get back on that though, because again, season 4 seems to be the season to watch and it gets really good in season 4. Again, love to know your thoughts on Ozark and all these other shows up on Anchor FM, Spotify and Twitter. The last two categories I'm going to read out are Best Supporting Actress in a Limited Series, Jennifer Coolidge for The White Lotus, and Outstanding Documentary, The Beatles Get Back. One nomination in the documentary category that I did watch was the Kanye trilogy. I thought it was a very good documentary and shot in a very unique way. It was referred to me by Jack McDonald and I did review it on his show. Overall, a great documentary that maybe was overlooked in this year's Emmys. But let me know if you've seen the Beatle documentary. Did it deserve to win the award? And let me know if you've seen the Kanye documentary and if you thought it was overlooked at this year's Emmys. That is my roundup of this year's Emmy winners and what has been an outstanding year for TV. A few downsides to this year's Emmys. There was a joke that went on too long with Jimmy Kimmel and Quinta Brunson. Quinta Brunson winning Best Writing for a series with the pilot of Abbott Elementary, and her acceptance speech was cut short by Jimmy Kimmel and a joke that seemed to never end. Naturally, Kimmel got a good bit of backlash for this joke and stealing what was a significant moment for Quinta Brunson with her Emmy win. And the TV host did come out and apologize for an ill-timed joke and having it run for as long as it did. However, Brunson did get her payback. She arrived on Wednesday's taping of Jimmy Kimmel's show and said that she wanted to use her time to finish off her acceptance speech, which I thought was very funny. I'm glad she got her payback, because again, to steal someone's moment like that, it's never okay. And whether he meant to do it or not, at least he came out and apologized, and at least Quinta Brunson has kind of approached this the right way. Again, the last thing we all wanted was another slap moment like the Oscars. Love to know your thoughts around this incident up on Anchor FM, Spotify and Twitter. But overall, I thought the Emmys was a great night to acknowledge great TV, and it helped shine a light on some great TV shows that have helped a lot of people over the past year. Let me know if you thought there were any TV shows, any actors or actresses or writing cast members that were overlooked at this year's Emmys. And let me know if you had any favorites for certain categories that you were disappointed weren't recognized for their work. I know I personally was rooting for Adam Scott to win Best Actor in a Drama for Severance, but again, you can't overlook Lee Jun-jae in Squid Game. He was just excellent. So I can't really say that I'm mad about him winning the award, because it was duly deserved. In last week's episode, I gave an initial review of the first episode of She-Hulk after watching it. Didn't really get good marks from me. I thought the CGI was terrible. didn't really like the main character of Jessica Walters. I think it's Jennifer or Jessica. I think it's Jessica. Keep on forgetting. But overall, wasn't impressed and wasn't optimistic about watching the rest of the series. I did, however, give the next few episodes a chance. And there was 3 episodes in total that I watched. The next episode was surrounding the Abomination, played by Tim Roth, who I really love in everything he's in. So I gave it a chance. Overall, it's not a terrible show. I'm just not in tune with it. I don't think I've been in tune with any Marvel content lately. There's only been like 1 or 2 movies that I've really gravitated towards, really loved. And that was Spider-Man Homecoming. Or no, Spider-Man No Way Home and Avengers Endgame. And I think looking back on it, the only TV series from Marvel that I've actually really loved is WandaVision. Really liked that series. She-Hulk, I have no investment in it. No real connection to the characters. Again, not a huge Marvel fan. I am a fan of just TV in general. Overall, like I said, no real connection to the characters. It's something to watch. And I am kind of curious where the story goes, where the characters go. From what I've seen online, I think the next few episodes are around her trying to go on a dating website and find someone that loves her for her and not being the She-Hulk, because now she's publicly known across the world as She-Hulk, attorney at law. Overall, this series is meh. It's gone from crap to meh, in my opinion. And right now, if I had to sum up the show in one sentence, it would be this.
I mean, it's all right.
Overall, I'm going to give She-Hulk, I think, maybe a 2 out of 5 so far. There is some promise for the character, but overall, the CGI is still awful. I'm not invested in the characters, but perhaps, like I mentioned, there is still some hope for it. Let me know if you're watching the She-Hulk series right now, what you think of it, if you have similar opinion to me, or if you're enjoying the show. Let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify, and Twitter. I discussed a movie a couple of weeks ago on the podcast called Greatest Beer Run Ever. The movie stars Zac Efron and is focused around a real life story of a man who traveled over to Vietnam during the war to give his buddies some beer. I am really excited to see this movie, but I want to just talk about Zac Efron for a minute and not his acting ability. We all know he has come on so well as an actor and has really kind of tapped into his serious roles a lot over the past couple of years, as well as his comedy. But just talking about the way his face has changed the past while, because there was a big change in his facial features. I think it was last year, over the space of a couple of weeks, there were pictures that came out of Zac Efron looking like he had got a botched surgery or some bad filler. And I have seen him in interviews looking not like himself. And I thought, okay, it's surgery that went wrong or filler that went wrong. You know, it is prevalent in Hollywood. But I was thinking, why would he do that? He's such a good looking guy already, you know. And I'd seen him in that show he was on, I think Down to Earth, and he looked normal in that. And a couple of weeks later, those photos came out. Come to find out, I think it was this past week, I think it was a couple of days ago actually, 1 or 2 days ago, it came up on my For You page on TikTok that he actually dislocated his jaw, broke his jawbone, and his jawbone ended up hanging off his face and he had to get reconstructive surgery. And that's why his face is bloated up like that, especially around his jawline and his chin. Especially his chin, it looks really bad. Not bad, but it looks really bloated and prominent. And that seems to be the cause for his facial change and his facial features looking different right now. And when I saw that, I felt 2 things. I felt sorry for him and I felt bad for him, because that's obviously such a terrible thing to happen. And secondly, I felt guilty because I kind of judged him and was judging him in my mind around getting filler and ruining his face like that, when plenty of other people do it in Hollywood, including women and men. But I was kind of judging Zac Efron around the idea of doing that. So I felt guilty in that sense as well. You know, it's obvious that we all judge people in Hollywood and celebrities, and we hold them to a different scale than normal people, which I never see the point of. You know, filler, if you want to get filler, that's fine. You know, it's your own prerogative, it's your own reasoning behind it, it's your decision. It shouldn't have anything to do with me or the person beside you or the person down the street, you know, it's your choice. Do what you want. It's your body. It's your face. And normally the kind of stance I take is, if you're not hurting anyone, who gives a shit? Go crazy. So I kind of felt bad that I made a snap judgment there and a judgment around Zac Efron getting that done. Let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify and Twitter if you're excited for this movie and if you're a fan of Zac Efron. Here's what the actor had to say around his role in The Greatest Beer Run Ever.
I remember the day that I got the script. I read the script start to finish in probably the length of the movie, 90 minutes. And for me, that's like a feat. So I could not believe that this was a true story.
The actor goes on to say how proud he is to get the role and that he wants to do the role justice for the person he's portraying. This is where I'm going to end today's episode. I know it's a shorter one than usual, but I'm still trying to get to terms and come to terms with the new schedule I have in Midwest Radio. And once I have the time to put out longer episodes, I will. But at the moment, this is the best I can do. And as well as that, obviously, I want to put across 100% to my role in Midwest while I'm with them and really learn from the experience. So again, if you do see a change in the scheduled uploads of the podcast, that's why. I won't be getting around to them every week from now on. Realistically, I would like to have uploads every week, but with the new schedule, it'll be something like every 2 weeks I'll have an episode up. Let me know if you're kind of in the same path that I am, if you're starting a new job or an internship. How's it going? Where are you working? Are you enjoying it? Let me know up on Anchor FM, Spotify, and Twitter. This has been Is It Recording with Kyle Duffy. Thanks for listening. This brings the episode to a close. I hope you all enjoyed it. If you did, make sure to check out the rest of my catalogue available on Spotify, Google Podcasts, and Anchor FM. Whatever podcast platform you listen to, make sure to give Is It Recording some love. Give it a follow and share the episode with your friends. I'm very excited to be on this journey with the podcast and happy to have you along for the ride. New episodes are available every Friday, so make sure you never miss out. This has been Is It Recording with Kyle Duffy. Thanks for listening.